Hi, you're listening to Kate Palmer from sparkletart.com.
I'm going to be showing you how to do some distress colouring with the distress ink pads and a wet brush or water brush if you prefer. But this isn't going to be your pretty happy summery kind of image. None of those pink-cheeked cherubic kind of things here. Oh no, we're going dark, baby. We're going dark. Most of the distress ink techniques out there are for beautiful brights or perfectly gorgeous pale pastel colours. Today I'm going to show you something grungy, dark and gothic and multi-layered. Bit more me. So I hope you enjoy. For this next step, I'm going to use VersaFine ink to stamp my gorgeous image from Sweet Pea Stamps onto some Arche watercolour cardstock. I'm going to colour my image with distress inks. I'm using a size 2 round brush. I have a tiny little bit of water in a pan. I have a piece of paper towel to dry my brush on. And I keep all of these things relatively close. So they're just at the side of my image here. A few basics about distress ink colouring you might need to know. Less water is better. You need to make sure each layer is dry before adding more colour or else it bleeds badly. After you've put the ink on your brush, touch the brush to the area that you want to be darkest first. Ink will bleed into wet areas, so make sure each area is super dry before moving on to the next one. Layer colours to achieve depth, darker colours or blend. And finally, clean your brush and dry it off often. Most distress ink colouring follows the same kind of process. You need to wet your brush, wipe off the excess on a paper towel, dip it into some distress ink on a piece of plastic as a palette. Apply the ink to wherever you want it darkest on your image first, and then blend and shade out. Now there's a few ways to do that, and I'll talk you through it as I do the first layer of skin. I'm using tea dye for this first layer. To colour her face, I'm going to use the most common way of distress ink colouring. You wet your brush and wipe the excess water off on some paper towel. You pick a little bit of the colour up from a palette or the lid, and then you apply this to where you want the darkest shading on the image, for example, just underneath her hair. Then, without adding any more water or any more ink, after colouring the darkest areas, you use the ink that's left on the brush to colour the rest of the area. So, for example, on her face, you'll notice I'm doing all of the darkest areas first, and then I'm just using small strokes and little circles to colour the rest of the face. Without adding any more ink or taking any off, you'll notice it gives a beautiful blend. If you notice any lines on what you've just coloured, there are two ways to fix this. The first is by going over the lined area while it's still wet with just water on the brush. This will help soften the colour. The second way to fix it is to add a little bit more colour just so that it sort of blends a bit more naturally. It will make the area a bit darker, but it also removes the line. Sometimes when using this method, you kind of run out of colour and it ends up a little bit pale. So to fix that, or to add more colour, what you just need to do is finish colouring in the area so it's a little bit damp. This is what I'm about to do on the arm that you're watching now. Once the area is fully damp, you can then pick a little bit more colour up with your brush and use the natural tendency for the ink to bleed into wet areas to help you shade. And that's what I've just done. If you need to at this point, you can always add a little bit more water to help that blend. This is probably my favourite way to apply colour because it gives a beautiful graded result that looks really natural. But there are a few other ways to apply the distress ink. I finished her body using the same process because I love the way that it looks for skin. So just a reminder, what I'm doing is I'm cleaning off the brush each time so I know exactly how much ink's on it. I'm dipping it into the water. I'm removing the excess on a paper towel. I'm picking up a little bit of the ink from a palette or the lid of the ink, and then I'm applying that very first touch to wherever I want it to be darkest. I'm then using the same ink on the brush to apply to the rest of the area. Don't forget, you can always go back and make this darker. It's very difficult to take the colour away, so it pays to be gentle on that first application.
Let that sit for about 15 minutes to dry and then add a little bit of tattered rose. I'm going to use a nice clean brush and apply two small spots of tattered rose to her cheeks. Then I'm going to clean off the brush completely. While it's still a little wet, just go over those little cheek spots so that you don't end up with the magnolia cheek effect. So the nice little pink circle. Whilst that might be great on cute images, for this it's not really what I was after. Then, just to sort of add an extra dimension to some of the skin, I'm going to go over the whole piece with tattered rose. It just turns it a little bit from yellow to pink. I'm going to go back and add a little bit more tea dye. This is the second way to add some colour. It's layering. So what you would do is, using the same technique I showed you earlier, add a second layer of colour over one you've already put down. Now don't forget it has to be dry. Now for this second layer, you can choose to add colour over the entire image you've already coloured again, or, as I like to do, just towards the edges and then use a little water to blend it out. This really helps make the shadows pop while keeping those other areas quite light. It's fantastic for adding deeper shadows. Next, I'm going to use milled lavender. I'm going to colour in the dress and the wings using this. There's no real technique, it's just a matter of laying down the colour onto those areas of the base coat. Now, up until this point, it's been quite a lot like normal distress ink colouring, if a little bit darker. From here on in is where it gets grungy, so bear with me. It's going to look like a red hot mess for a few of these steps until I'm finished. The reason I'm doing this is because without these base layers, without all of this extra effort, you'll end up with a very bland looking image. Now I'm going to use the tea dye to add a little bit of depth to the milled lavender. I'm going to apply it just where the shadows would be. I'm going to add a little colour and then use the water to sort of blend out the edges. I was a little impatient here and didn't wait for the milled lavender to finish drying. As you can see, I get a little bleeding.
Now, when you're adding these darker colour, this is where things can go pear-shaped pretty quickly. Because some of these colours are quite strong, you need to be extremely careful about how much you're adding, where you're adding, just a little bit more careful than you would otherwise.
This is where you begin to see the actual effect of the layering, or the grungy layering. I'm adding the layer of Dusty Concord, and this is where things start to get darker, but it's not my final layer yet. Now, if I'd been smarter, I would have waited until this was completely dry, but I was having so much fun I didn't want to wait, so I kept going. You're about to see what happens when you don't wait for the layers to dry underneath. Now, I've left this in so that you can see what will happen, and then I'll give you an idea about what you can do to fix it. You don't have a lot of options, so it really is best to wait for the layers underneath to dry.
Now, this one is now far too wet, and right now I'm running the risk of having it bleed everywhere. So I'm going to need to move on to, and there it goes. See, it's bleeding all over the place, way too wet. Thankfully, there are ways to fix that afterwards. So that's what I'll be doing.
You might have noticed I'm using a slightly different technique here. Like normal, I'm applying the brush to the darkest areas first, but I'm also using a very small circular motion in some areas to sort of move the colour around. Now, it doesn't really blend in the traditional sense, but you can kind of move the colour.
So darkening and then just brushing up slightly. Now again, I can see that's far too wet. Sometimes it's a little difficult to get the amount of water on the brush right. I've got to work at it a bit. That's why I've found that I can't do this technique with a water brush. I found that it's just too inconsistent, the amount of water coming out of the actual brush tip, and I get far too much water on my image and I get bleeding and all sorts of yucky, nasty things happening. To clean up any mistakes, wet your brush, take a little bit of the water off, and then go over the areas. Now, the rest of it needs to be quite dry, otherwise you'll just cause more bleeding. Now, this won't get rid of everything, but it will help soften the colour.
Next, I'm going to use walnut stain to colour the hair.
Now, the hair's not going to have as many layers as, for example, the wings or the dress. So whatever sort of effect you get on this first layer will show through on the final layer. So you really want to make sure that you've got some dark areas where the hair would be darker, and you leave some lighter areas where you want the sort of, you know, light to be reflecting off the hair. So of course I'm going to make the tips of the hair darker and leave the crown of her hair lighter. Now this is using the same technique as I've used for the skin. So applying to the darkest area first and then just keeping on using the colour that's left on the brush until it runs out. Then dipping it back into the water, cleaning it off and repeating the process over again. That way you get to control exactly how much colour is on the brush at any one time. You might end up with lines here. The way I've coloured, some of those darker areas have dried before I've had a chance to go back in and blend the colour out. To fix that up, I've just gone in and added another layer of colour, sort of deepens the area and blends out any of those lines. You might prefer to leave your image like this, but I'm going for a really dark, grungy look, so it's going to need one more layer of colour. Wait till it's completely dry. This last layer bleeds easily. For the final layer, I'm going to be adding black soot. You need to be really careful here because it's an extremely strong colour, so you need to get your brush as dry as possible when you're applying this. So what I'm doing for the black soot is I'm going to be applying it over the top of her dress, wings and hair. I'll be applying the black soot in a slightly modified way. So you still need to clean your brush between each layer of ink or each sort of section of ink. But this time, instead of just giving it a quick wipe on the paper towel, you need to really try and make sure the brush is almost dry before applying the distress ink to the brush. Once you have the ink on the brush, as per normal, touch it to the areas that you want to be the darkest first. But that's where things change slightly. For this colour, you will not be dipping the brush into clean water and adding additional water to blend. This whole section needs to be blended with a brush as dry as possible. So what I find for this particular area is it's easiest to work in a couple of layers. So add the darkest area first. Once you've got this very darkest layer down, you would then add a little less colour to the brush, and that's how you would add the slightly lighter areas. Make sure not to add black soot everywhere. Leave a little of the colour underneath to peek through. What I'm then going to do, once I've coloured the rest of the dress, is get as much ink on the brush as possible and use that to lay down some really dark lines for where the blackest shadows would be. The reason I've done the image the way I have is because, as you can see now, you're getting a black with depth to it. It's got colour, it's got shadows, it's got highlights. If you were to apply the black soot direct to the image as your only colour, all you would get is sort of a variation of grey. This way, your black actually looks alive, and I think you'll agree, the end result is a much more realistic colour.
My chickie is coloured, and she's nice and dark like I had hoped that she would be. So doing the first layer and adding down some of that other colour, whether it be the purple or the brown, just gives an undertone to the final colour.
Now, to fix up where that little section has bled, I've made a mask and covered my main image. The mask is actually clear plastic, so I promise I really have it covered. And now I'm using the Tim Holtz Distress Ink Blending Tool with the foam on there to add similar or the same, it's up to you, colours of Distress Ink that I've used to colour my image. What this means is that you get a background that basically covers up any little mistakes, blends beautifully with the image and really makes it pop. Now I'll come back and probably do a proper large clip later, but for the moment this is how it looks. I finished off my main image by adding a little bit of white paint just to highlight where the moon would hit the wings, the dress, the ground underneath her feet. I've used a pencil to colour in her eyes and her lips. I find that I just have a bit more control for those smaller areas. When you look up close, you can see that both her skin and the black areas have lots of depth to the colour, so it's much more interesting and realistic to look at. If you're interested in how I've made the background, either for the image or for the card background, which you're going to get a sneak peek at now, then make sure you check out my other clips. Both of these took a bit too long to fit into this one, so they'll each have their own clip. So I'll show you exactly how I've done the distress inking behind my main image and how I've created that gorgeous background, maybe even the flower. I hope you've enjoyed this trip to the dark side of distress colouring, and I hope even more that it's given you a few ideas about how you might do your distress colouring a little bit differently. Bye.